Black Chew TV. We're back in Jungle, Cricktown, with the infamous Ram Dog, a.k.a. Mad Dog himself. So, when was you born?
1961.
How old are you now?
I'm 59 years old.
Where did you grow up? Where was you born and where did you grow
well,
up?
Well, I was born in a little place named St. Anne's. Priory St. Anne's. That place grew a lot. That place grew a lot of, what I would say, gangster. Man like Butter, known as Gargalo. Butter in Tivoli Garden, known as Gargalo. Born the same place. Boopy Million, the man there. Born the same place.
So where did you grow up?
I grew up in St. Anne's and Kingston, back and forth. Jungle.
So great.
Waterhouse, Dunker.
Growing up in Jamaica in them times. How was it? How was it for you growing up?
Well, for me, it was nice and rough because the background I came from, some poor, some rich. Like my mother, like my father's side. Her mother's side was like kind of poor. Her father's side is kind of wealthy. So I take off from, I was a teenager at the age of 12, 13. Start the road, look my own. That's when things roll over and some people call it badness, but I call it a different name. I call it rudeness, but some people don't say bad, you know?
So that was the age you got into criminality? 12,
yeah. 13. Yeah, about 12, 13.
How did you make money back then?
Well, I used to be a getaway driver, you know. Getaway driver. You know? Getaway driver.
So, was you involved in any of the political activist criminality?
At certain time. But then I was on and off.
What age was you when you fired your first gun?
I was like about 14. A gun named called One Pop. I cut a bicycle bar.
Looking back, could you have avoided your lifestyle or was it the circumstances you were born into? Because you said that you had one side of your family was poor, one side of your family was rich, so you could have went both ways.
Yeah.
Looking back, would you change anything?
If it's like no, I would change. Because that wasn't the nice way to go down. That's why I asking these dudes them nowadays, these kids them coming up, not to take that road. Not to take that road down there. But like I said, back then when I started bad, badness did nice. It was like a plate of food, eating a plate of food. Nobody couldn't tell me nothing. My grandmother tried to curve me, my uncle and my auntie them would grow me. But badness was nice. Rudeness was nice. Nobody couldn't tell me. Just like the kids them nowadays.
So you've been to England, right?
Yeah, man. Been to...
What year did you go to England?
I went to England in 2000. After I came from America.
Was it a cultural shock for you? Obviously, you say you was in America, so you know about the cold and all that already. But going to England is different from America. How was it for you?
Well, when you're talking about coldness, cold weather,
yeah.
Well, it didn't bother me because I like the coldness more than the heat. Even though in my car, them, I always bought my AC. I don't like hotness, I like coldness.
So it wasn't a cultural shock. You adjusted easily.
I already adjusted to it. From back in the United States, I already adjusted to England. So when I went to England, it was nothing to me. Well, like I said, yeah, like I said, when I went to England, you know, I didn't went to England for criminal activity like America. I went to England for on a different channel, but then I said, you know, no man, I can't come work. So I jumped back into the game.
That's how you survived, right?
Yeah, man.
How long was you out there for before you came back?
Well, I used to back and front, you know. It's back and front. From England to Jamaica, England to Jamaica, Jamaica to England. But then I didn't get deported. I came back, I get grabbed, went and do a sentence for money laundering. And I came back in 2008. I didn't get deported. Signed myself out and came back to Jamaica.
So you've been back, you've been here since 2008, you've never tried to go back?
I've been back before. I've been back since I came back, but you know, authority don't know about it. No, we have our own way.
So what advice as a old dog, mad dog, ram dog yourself, what advice would you give the youth them of today that want to pick up the gun and feel like it's an okay thing to do and live that lifestyle?
Well, Sally, I have to say to him, you know, I wouldn't say good luck. Because if I say good luck, it's like I don't care about them. But I'm telling them, meditate first about education. Because growing up as a youth, I didn't have education. I went to prison and do a prison sentence. Spent 12 years, 6 months before I even beat my case and beat my appeal and come home. And that's where I learned to read and write. All my years I couldn't read and write. This prison make me read and write. And I get to understand that education is a key. So the youth them picking up a gun today, I like asking them for, don't try to be like us back then. Try to be like us now. That what changed our life. Cause I'm a businessman.
How many attempts on your life have you survived?
Enough. Enough. Right now, me not no belly right now. All I had shut out. Shut out through John, stuff like that. Because they talk about rude boy. Rude boy.
So you know all of the old school man that you know you've had around. You've seen you with Joe Dawg, you've seen you with lyrics. Who else do you know? Who else do you
know? Man, Sparrow, Willie Agard, no. Starsky, thing we call Boopy Dread, Million, all them on the Hacks. Enough, man. Enough.
How many?
Me call the dead man them name, you know, but me not call live man them name.
How many man from your era that used to call that's still alive today? You know, for them dead off or not for them?
Enough dead off, you know. Whole heap dead off. Some of them still alive. Some of them became businessmen like me. Even successful more than me.
So in your own words, is there anything you'd like to say to, like, you know, get your story across, get your point across? Because it's for the youth, but obviously the youth, you know how it is nowadays, especially with this COVID that's going around. People are hungry and people are doing crazy stuff. What would you say to them?
To the youth then, of today, be conscious, try to educate themselves. Because you can educate yourself, you know. Yeah, you can educate yourself. You can educate yourself. Yeah. So all I'm trying to tell them, try to educate themselves and try to caress wisdom and knowledge. Yeah, man. Yeah, man, them places, yeah, my place where me used to, when me left country, I come out of town and them places where me come to. Jungle, Waterhouse, Kirk. First time I go Kirk is one of my bridges named Joe. Buy from St. Anne, bring me a Kirk. I'm gonna say, I not for the badness when me learn a hymn me learning from.
And it wasn't, you wouldn't say it's peer pressure, you would just say it's just a way of life, just something that. How you had to survive, get how you
live. Yeah, it wasn't pressure, you know. Because growing up as a youth, just like me tell you, sir, part of my family, the wealthy, part poor. But I picked up because I want to hang on to the big guys them, the big man them. Man like where I look up to, like Juggy Zook still I'm a Dan from St. Anne, my uncle Andy Chin, Patty Powell, the man there, North Mormon Jabbar. Enough more, man. I used to want to be like them. Just like how me, I grew up more and be like Starsky, one be like Bucky Marshall, Claude Massop, Tony Welch. Them type of man, them type of thing there. Me the caress. Want to be the bad guy. I don't want to be like the good guy. Like the good cop, or the good doctor, or the good pilot. I want to be I want to be like the bad guys. The guys that might fire them gun and I rob. This is the thing where mental slavery. Because we do feel that there is nothing better than to be a bad guy, a rude guy. The gun. Right, it's a bad way, man.
That was the only way, like, that was the only way you could make money.
You understand?
For us as black people. But for us as coming from the ghetto, there's no better for you. I'm either doing this or I'm going to stop.
You see? Like I said again, I thought the only way to life was to be a rude, be a bad man. But reach up in age, I get to start to have grandkids and stuff like that. Even one great granddaughter, I have one great granddaughter. So that made me think a lot more about life and people's life.
So looking back on your life, with all your trials and tribulations, all the shit that you've been through, would you change anything? Would you do anything differently? Would you go a different way? How would you?
We say go a different way now.
Like, if you could change, if you say, for instance, like, looking back at your life now, if you could do anything different, would you do anything different?
Yeah. Yeah, sure. I would be a doctor right now or a pilot.
But that would make you.
Back then, that would be maybe a different person. But I have regrets, because a lot of things I regret. Evil stuff to people. Left people shed tears. You understand? It's not the way of life. I want for these youth nowadays. That's not the type of life I want for them. I don't have to know them to be a father for them. Cause I'm in age right now where I'm a father for all them dudes where I fire the gun now. Cause you're not fighting a 49-year-old man or a 50-year-old man a fire gun. I'll be a 17, 18, 19, 20 and 30, I'm gonna be them dad. Yeah man. I know one of you look up to me and say, boy, you know, say a rag dog that, a mad dog, a junglist that. Man, they don't want to be like them. No, you can't be like me. No. Because just like I said, I'm a businessman. I sit down and write song. I do many business. But if them say they want to be like me back then, no, I don't want to be like me back then. Be like me. No. The good guy that I am. Because no man can't judge me, no, but the Almighty, no. But join me. No man can't judge me. Only God can judge me. So, yeah, sometimes you hear people say bad things about you and you hurt you. And you blaze up. So, oh, wait. Because words hurt. Some people say words don't hurt, but it hurt me. Me don't know about nobody else. Yeah, man, words are power, man. I have been there and done it. Because enough of them you are bad right now. Them not bad like my little finger. Them not bad like my little finger. No, they don't bother like my little finger.
They don't leave them street, they don't leave their car, they're just bad in their own crew, bad in their friends.
Friend killers. Just like Joe Dog said earlier, friend killers.
No loyalty.
No loyalty. I'd rather leave my friend alone and depart than kill my friend. Because I have best friend, shoot me. I have best friend shoot me, you know, and me and them is friends, same way. Me have best friend that showed me. And me and him is best friend. One of my brethren named Jaman from Kirk showed me. And me and his best friend. Me love him same way because guess what? I'm afraid me afraid of him because I'm not afraid of nobody. But me just love him. Me just love him so me forgive him. Because if God forgive me, why can't we give our brethren? So I just said them brother, man.
Everybody's not
the yeah, same. Man.
Everybody don't have
Some people might look by and say, I hear that guy, him friend shoot him and him not kill back him friend. No. Me know my brethren, it wasn't his own mind. It was a thing when he's smoking. Because my brethren shoot me and then shed tears and sorry and shoot me. I know I'm sorry because that man shoot, that man, well, last time he get shot up, him shoot me. And when he get shot up, me, myself, wonder why I'm do it. And me never ask him say why I'm do it. But him tell all him family and tell him friends them say, yo, you're the only man him shoot where ever regret on earth. I mean, I'm hurt deep inside. I mean, love him. And anything me have, we share, give him. Same way. So I start going, bro.